I am Mohammed Tavakkoli, the inaugural director of the Elahé Mir-Djalali Institute of Iranian Studies at the University of Toronto. I welcome you all to our bi-weekly Elahé Omidyar Mir-Djalali seminar series, Iranian Cinema, which I am co-convening with Professor Gulbarg Kaptalayi of Seton Hall University and Dr. Khatir Shaybani of York University. At the outset, I would like to express our collective gratitude to Canada's Indigenous people and acknowledge this land on which the University of Toronto operates. For thousands of years, it has been the traditional land of the Huron, Wendat, the Seneca, and most recently, the Mississauga of Credit River. Today, this meeting place is still the home of many Indigenous people from across Turtle Island, and we are grateful to have the opportunity to work and prosper on this land. I would like to welcome to the University of Toronto my distinguished colleague and friend, Professor Hamid Naficy. My colleague and collaborator, Dr. Khatir Shaybani, will introduce Professor Naficy and moderate today's session. Dr. Shaybani.
It is my pleasure, my honor to be included in this, and such a great, this is great to have Professor Naficy as the very first speaker of the series in the new academic year. Professor Naficy doesn't need to be introduced. He is a leading authority in cultural studies of diaspora, exile, and post-colonial cinemas and media, and of Iranian and Middle Eastern cinemas and media. His areas of research and teaching include these topics, as well as documentary and ethnographic cinemas. He has published nearly a dozen books in English and in Persian, some award-winning, and scores of book chapters and journal articles. In addition, he has lectured widely, nationally and internationally, and his works have been cited and reprinted extensively and translated into many languages. Professor Naficy has also produced many educational films and experimental videos and participated in major international film festivals, curated film series, and initiated the annual Iranian Film Festivals in Los Angeles in 1990 and in Houston in 1992. Professor Naficy might have taught many thousands of students, but also he has taught us, I guess remotely through his books, his articles. We all learned and were inspired from him. And this is a new topic. I'm very excited, Iranian internet cinema. Welcome, Dr. Naficy.
Thank you so much, Khatir Jan and Muhammad Jan, as well, for this interview. And my talk is about an emergent form of cinema in whose production and propagation most of us have participated in one way or another. And this is the cinema that I'm calling internet cinema. I will concentrate on its manifestation in Iran around the political turmoil of 2009, the Green Movement. With the success of the revolution, the Islamic Republic took over the broadcast media and placed it under direct control of the supreme leader. Having gotten rid of the authoritarian Pahlavi regime with a monopolistic state-run broadcast media consisting of vast national networks of radio and television, Iranians did not take this lying down. In the 1980s and 1990s, they engaged in a creative cat and mouse game with the state to create a thriving black markets for alternative people's media, as they call them, particularly for video distribution and satellite television. I have documented these extensively in my 4-volume book on Iranian social history of Iranian cinema. But they did not stop there. In the 2000s and beyond, they added a third front in the struggle to create an alternative people's medium. This was internet cinema, with which Iranians challenged the state's media monopoly and mono-vocalism. However, this internet cinema is a new and legitimate artistic and expressive form on its own, regardless of its political uses. Iranian cosmopolitanism, financial richness of the country, youthful and educated population, ethnic diversity, and widespread penetration of the internet and its various modalities of connectivity and interactivity drove the emergence of the internet cinema. For example, in 2005, CIA officers at the Open Source Center, a new division of the organization created to monitor public sources of information, discovered that Persian was among the top 5 languages in the blogosphere, offering valuable textual and audiovisual information and insight about Iranian people and their sentiments. Later studies showed that Iran has the most internet users in the Middle East, approaching 30 million. However, I must warn that these figures are ambiguous, as it is not clear how the number of bloggers is calculated and what constitutes an Iranian blog. If the physical location of bloggers is the criteria, counting only those inside Iran, the calculations would ignore the large number of bloggers in diaspora. If the language of blogging is considered Persian, then all those Iranians, dual national Iranians and non-Iranians who write in other languages about Iran are ignored. No matter how they are counted, Iranian diaspora bloggers formed a formidable presence in the blogosphere in particular and in the cyberspace in particular, in general. Because of this presence and because of the strangling of the other forms of journalism, the internet has become a vital source of information and activism in the 2000s for all sides and a highly contested public diplomacy sphere. The emergence of blogging and allied practices such as community reporting, social networking, and video sharing turned the internet's virtual space into a vast online public sphere, which in turn encouraged discursive formations and political activism in the society. The internet thus became social, not only in its virtuality, but also in its actuality. The streets in turn became virtual, both in their powerful representation on the screen and in their power to represent. One of these discursive formations was the internet cinema, and the social formation that it helped mobilize was the opposition Green Movement, which emerged after the 2009 disputed election, which re-elected Mahmoud Ahmadinejad as president, a movement that demanded government accountability and democracy. This movement posed the biggest challenge in the lifespan of the Islamic Republic, not only to its legitimacy, but also to its existence. What I am calling internet cinema vastly differs from what we normally mean by cinema and by its products, namely movies. Internet films differ from motion picture films in several ways, and this is a list of them. They differ in their mode of production, the status of the filmmakers, that is who makes the film's textual system, that is the way the story is told, the way the films are distributed and exhibited, and finally, the way they are received by the spectators on TV, on internet, on cell phone, etc. The negative consequences of the shift in the US and Iranian public diplomacies from gathering secret information from enemy countries through espionage to collecting information from public sources in those countries, such as through the internet, are that it politicizes, even militarizes all public spheres, including the streets and the internet. As a result, both people and government in Iran became camera shy in public places, in major cities, and a kind of disembodied filming emerged. If someone took out a camera to take a picture in the streets, both government agents and passersby would harass the person, one fearing that the image would be uploaded to social networking sites or to oppositional sites, feeding the gathering anti-regime dissent. The other fearing government surveillance and future arrests. As a result, some of the early protest videos were filmed almost clandestinely from private and semi-private places, like from balconies and from inside apartments and offices, from behind curtains and so forth. The government attempted to remove, impede, or block these public sources of information and to surveil, track down, imprison, and severely punish the internet operators and users it considered aiding the dissenters. Ironically, the U.S. sanctions against the Islamic Republic too initially contributed to suppressing the digital uprisings of the Iranians. So I'm going to talk a little bit about the embodied form of filming in public places. The regime's impediment and censorship efforts did not deter the opposition. Instead, it encouraged a creative but sometimes deadly and violent cat and mouse game, both on the internet and in the streets, leading to an embodied style of filming. Protesters found ever more ingenious alternatives to stay in touch, to coordinate and to organize their protest, and they sought new strategies, internal and international, to create an alternative non-governmental media scape to publicize their own activities and grievances, to document those protests, and to monitor police reactions and violence. Many resorted to proxies, which redirected them to banned sites, or used anonymizers, which concealed identities of senders and recipients. In terms of their production practice, they used simple equipment. This was the moment for the efflorescence of a new little medium, the internet cinema, in contrast to the big media of movies and broadcast TV. This little medium, with its simple equipment, a mobile phone or a consumer digital camera recorder, not only replaced those big media, but also the formerly powerful little medium of analog audio cassettes, which Ayatollah Khomeini had used so effectively to energize the Islamic Revolution in the late 1970s. This was the visual iteration of that. This was a new era necessitating a new medium for a new cause. Each protester became a digital medium and a historiographer by taking to the streets, digital camera, cell phone, or recorder in hand, defying government's threats of force and terror and its monopoly on the big media. They began to record their videos from the turmoil in the streets, at ground level, and from a close-up view, instead of from the safety of the high-rise buildings or from behind windows and curtains as before. With this shift from the private to the public space and from a distant view to a close-up view of the subjects came other fundamental political and aesthetic changes in what was recorded. Production became democratized, as anyone with a cell phone camera was a potential filmmaker and broadcaster, not needing professional training. Social barriers and divisions, such as those separating genders, crumbled. That is why women were such a strong and defiant presence, both in the streets as demonstrators and as camera people. And their videos were on the internet, public community internet. I have in my presentation PowerPoint, I have pictures of people in the streets in various positions, taking images of the streets of people completely bloodied, complete the head smashed on the asphalt. You know, they were terrible scenes, like some of the ones that we are seeing now in other places. The other aspect, in terms of, I want to emphasize that, is the production mode of these films. Instead of recording what they were seeing from the point of view of an outsider observing events as before, community videographers began to record from the POV of insiders engaged in the action. Their recording mode thus shifted from direct cinema's fly-on-the-wall observation of outside events to cinema verite's provocation come recording of events in which they themselves participate. And this is a very important shift that occurred in the 1960s and 70s in the US and Europe, the shift from direct cinema filming, which is basically being fly on the wall and shooting the subjects without directing them, without talking to them, without interacting with them. And they basically trying to ignore the filmmakers in the process. So the cinema verite is a proactive style of filmmaking where the camera actually provokes sometimes the subjects to be who they would not be normally. And they show some of their internal and hidden elements. And so these two film movements became important documentary film movements in the West and in Iran as well. There is also something to be said about the aesthetics of these films. I'm calling it amateur aesthetics. As such, theirs was not a simple recording of protest that someone else had organized, but an embodied form of protest in whose organization they themselves participated with all the subjectivity, ambiguity, and hapticity. That is roughness, shakiness, and out of focus and chaotic filming and muffled sound that they presented. And this is what I mean by embodied camera. The camera is not an objective camera on a tripod outside the action. The camera is in the middle of the action. The cameraman oftentimes is running or climbing the stairs or hanging from a tree or something and is filming. The hand is shaking, the focus is not very good, all of that stuff. So it is an embodied camera that really viscerally carries the audience into the action. So the result was an unedited raw footage of action and affect, not edited film of a polished presentation. And I wish I could show you some of the images to see them. Some of these images were very powerful when uploaded onto the internet, video sharing and social networking sites, bypassing government control and censorship. The slogans also that the participants were using also point to some of these characteristics of the medium. One of them was "My phone, my medium." The slogan that protesters carried testified to the changed mission of the filmers and that of this new little embodied filmic medium. The phone was no longer for private communication or a conversation. It was considered a medium for public communication with the rest of the world. Another slogan was, "Every Iranian a historiographer." Very pithy, but I think very profound. Who are these video historians filming these events? I make a distinction between filmers and videographers and filmmakers. The filmmakers and videographers that we are discussing here are amateur filmers, not professional filmmakers. They work spontaneously in an unplanned, unscripted manner. They work alone and are often anonymous, which means they do not benefit from authorial recognition and financial gain of their profession. They work underground without official authorization. They also work outside journalistic institutions that verify the authenticity of events, people, places, and confer value on their result. The production of the internet cinema that I'm talking about occurs in three distinct phases. In the first phase, community videos are filmed by people with digital cameras, which are uploaded to internet sites without editing. Phase two, in a growing practice, a second phase evolved, during which others who were not necessarily involved in the first phase blogged about them or shared, compiled, aggregated, repurposed, edited, and uploaded these internet videos to create other fictional or non-fictional videos and music videos. This is what I call internet films, the products of this phase and more. Another one of the, remarkable videos that I'm sure you remember is the video of Neda Sultan dying on camera. And this, the people around her are shouting at her, Neda Naro, Neda Naro, Neda Vosta. And you can see life expiring from her eyes. I mean, just an amazingly powerful video. I mean, this couldn't have been scripted. And this was, of course, uploaded to the internet and became a kind of a cause célèbre. The next phase is distribution. And like most movie distribution, which requires professional distributors, the amateur filmer is also the primary distributor of the internet community videos herself. His or her distribution is not just individualized, but also significantly globalized because of the internet. In this way, ordinary videographers become not only extraordinary producers, but also extraordinary extraterritorial distributors, who bypass the traditional commercial and governmental distribution system with their complicated monopolistic and competitive techno-political economies. In the case of the Al Sultan video, for example, the anonymous filmer forwarded the video to the British newspaper, The Guardian, to Voice of America, and five other individuals. Significantly, according to the newspaper, one of these latter individuals uploaded the video onto Facebook, not the filmer himself or herself, showing the two-step production of internet films. From that one posting, copies spread to YouTube and were broadcast within hours by CNN. This video was then used or served to inspire numerous types of internet films, including fiction, documentary, and of course, music videos, and even animated films. It is thus that this single video went viral and became simultaneously an icon, an index, and a symbol of the post-election protest and of the democratic aspirations of Iranians, the Green Movement, fulfilling all the three definitions of the sign in Charles Sander Peirce's semiology. The next phase in after distribution is the exhibition of these films. The exhibition venue of the internet cinema vastly differs from other forms of cinema. It shifts from the stationary brick and mortar movie houses where people watch movies collectively according to a schedule to the small mobile handheld devices, which could be viewed by any individual with internet access at any time and anywhere in the world. This means that internet films exhibition is freed from both physical location and physical structures, becoming global and virtual, even viral, potentially. In short, in all its phases of production, distribution, exhibition, and reception, internet cinema moves from professional and formal to amateur and personal forms, marking the ultimate triumph of modernity's individuality in Iranian cinema, cinematic expression. now onto the reception phase. The rubber of the internet films hits the road with the viewers, who are not passive receivers of pre-made films, but active interactants in creating new phase three films. They choose the order of the film clips, all of us, that is, who watch these videos. We choose the order in which the film clips are watched by us, sharing some of them, blogging about some of them to others. Each viewer, therefore, creates her own film by this process, which is different from the others' films, for they click on different videos. Because of this, and because many of these film postings are ephemeral, no single unified authorial film text exists. As a result, the real author of the internet film, the filmmaker, is none other than the viewer, who is also the film's secondary distributor, exhibitor, and critic. This is a radical shift in cinema from professional to amateur and from filmmaker to the viewer, triumph of modernity and individuality. Internet cinema is more democratic than traditional cinema because of its spontaneous amateur production mode, its non-hierarchical production, open textuality, and viewer interactivity. Now, a little bit about the global diasporic dimensions of this before I close. Iranian diasporic population contribution to the internet films contribute to internet films in several ways. This population helps to globalize the film by sharing the first phase clips on social networking sites or streaming sites, by blogging about it, by forwarding it to Western news organizations. They also contribute by repurposing them to make other films, documentaries, fiction films, and especially music videos. I close with two such music videos. Alas, I can't show them to you, but I'll name them to you, and maybe Khatere can find it on internet and post it. One is by an outfit called Blurred Vision, and the title of it is Another Brick in the Wall. The subtitle is, Hey Ayatollah, Leave Those Kids Alone.
We don't need just another brick in the wall. All in all, you're just another brick in the wall.
Can you try one more?
Yes, if you...
It's a song by Shaheen Najafi, and it is called Nari Nari.
نقی تو رو لسم به شوخ تبیل به این بیرون از گود کتب به آلت بزرگ زندگان که پشت ما نشست رو به تهدی نقی تو رو به طول عرض تهدی دولار رو به رشد و حس تقی نقی تو رو به امام مغوا به طفل علی بوی توی رحم گی به درس فقط و اتاق عمل بین به آقا و تسبیح و جان نماز چی نقی تو رو به انگشت شیس رضای به دینی که آوت شد و فوتبال دینی آینه حالا که مهد تو خواهی ما تو رو صدا میزنیم آی نقی تو زور کن که ما آماده تو کفنیم آی نقی حالا که مهد تو خواهی ما تو رو صدا میزنیم آی نقی تو زور کن که ما آماده تو کفنیم آی نقی نقی تو رو قسم به عشق و بیاد را تو رو به لنگه ی هوا شده و چاپ تو رو به سنگت مرغ و گوشت و ماو سینه ی سیلیکونی و به کارت راه رو نقی تو رو به ممه های گل شفته به آب روگی نداشتی که از مروی نقی تو رو به نجاد آوری آوی به پلاکی که به گردن آویخته نقی جون من تو رو به ششول فرم 3,000 میلیارد زیر گنبده که خلیج فارس و رومیه هم قصه واسه اسم رهبر جنبش سبز چی بود آی نقی حالا که مهد خواب ما تو رو صدا میزنیم آی نقی تو زور کن که ما آماده تو کفنیم آی نقی حالا که مهد خواب ما تو رو صدا میزنیم آی نقی تو زور کن که ما آماده تو کفنیم آی نقی آی نقی آی نقی آی نقی آی نقی آی نقی رحلت جان روز امام عمر به سیاسی و فسیلی درو به بیوه های با کلاس و کلاس دیز به احسای روشن فکریت به غیرت مردای اون کار به زنان مدافع حقوق من به انقلاب رنگی از تلویزیون به سه درس جمعیت کتاب خود تو رو به شعر یا آب کیو تو خال نگی تو رو به این جماعت حالی به حال صبح زنده باد میگن و شب مرد به قهرمان های قصه های خیال آی نهی حالا که مهد خواب ما تو رو صدا میزنیم آی آی کنگی ما آماده تو کنیم آی نقی حالا که مهدی خواب ما تو رو صدا میزنیم آی نقی تو دور کن که ما آماده تو کنیم آی نقی آی نقی آی نقی آی نقی آی نقی آی نقی
All right. خیلی متشکر خاطر جان. اگه به ویدیو نگاه کرده باشین با دقت the shape of the shrine resembles a female breast. Look at it again, and it's just an amazing rendition of it. And of course the song is full of description of sexual kind of stuff that apparently Khamenei, Nagi refers to Khamenei, of course. This film, in a way, just one last word about it, this film in a way gives us an example of what would be called counter-interpolation or counter-hailing. If you recall Louis Althusser's example of interpolation or hailing is this: you're walking down the street and a policeman says from behind you, "Hey, you there." You turn around to face the person who's warned you. And by turning around, you become the subject of the police. You've been interpolated. In the Islamic Republic, the state hails and addresses the citizens by its monopolistic broadcast and other media, which propagate dominant ideology. The state enforces that ideology by its control of the coercive forces, as well as the police, armed forces, security, and intelligence services. The citizens can hail an authoritarian state by creating their own ideological apparatuses, such as black market videos, installing clandestine satellite receivers on their rooftops in their homes. I've documented a lot of these in my book. Creating black market videos, installing clandestine satellite receivers on their rooftops, and creating internet films, such as the music video that we've been talking about, which are powerful in counter-hailing the government. That is, they talk back to and undermine the state. And this is an amazingly brave thing to do in a place where the state dominates almost all means of propagation. But these individual media makers are vulnerable to the state's coercive forces, as Shohin Najafi found out when he recreated this video that criticized Khamenei. He received death threat and a death fatwa and went into hiding. Both the production of counter-hailing videos and the reaction of the state can turn internet filmers into heroic characters, pushing them into unwanted political leadership and make them better targets for government action. Lastly, this sort of effective internet film augurs not only entirely new relations with its social subjects, as described so far, but also it creates new relations of production, distribution, exhibition, and reception with its viewers. While the site of production in its initial phases are primarily public places, either in the streets or underground, its site of reception is chiefly private places, homes, and other private or semi-private locations. Production is ad hoc, spontaneous, amateurish, and without official permission, bypassing the strict government approval and censorship apparatuses. As such, internet cinema is inherently an unauthorized underground cinema. Its technology of recording is no longer optical and chemical, involving celluloid film, but entirely electronic and digital. This technological shift facilitated the globalized production and distribution of the internet cinema video. Wassalam.